cap, I'm real. No cap, I'm real. The plastic bars from a copy my steel. Copy my steel. It's the fact that ain't no cap, I'm real. No cap, I'm real. The plastic bars from a copy my steel.
Got my heart, no.
Very pleasant good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to the Casino at Dania Beach and the best in professional highlight brought to you by Dania Highlight. We have a 9-game performance on tap for you tonight, starting out with 2 singles matches. Game 1 singles begins the early daily double. And game 2 will complete that daily double. Those are both singles. Then we'll get into some doubles action into the evening. Starting out with game 3, we'll have doubles. And that will be a spectacular 9 doubles match. 3 spectacular 9 games that feature the big paying superfecta. They are games 3, 6, and 9. We have a pick 4. It starts out in game 6. We have 2 pick 3s. The first one in game 3. The second one in game 7. And as mentioned, the daily double starts here in games 1 and 2. At this time, there are no changes in tonight's official program. We ask you to make your selections early in each betting period. Don't wait till the last second. Take the chance of getting shut out. First game starts now in 7 minutes.
Thank you.
There is less than 5 minutes remaining now for betting on the first game and the early daily double. Less than five. And now 2 minutes remain for betting on the first game and the early daily double. Post time, 2 minutes. Final call for betting on the first game and the daily double. Final call. And we're set to get underway, ladies and gentlemen, tonight. Before we do, we'd like to start off the evening by having you please rise as we honor America with a playing of our national anthem.
Thank you.
This is tonight's first game. It is a singles match played with spectacular seven scoring. Serving and wearing red in post one is Tupole. Receiving in blue, post two will be Virutia. Tukule makes the approach, there's the serve, and the game is on. First point to the two. One and two. And so the two takes the first 3 points of the game. He'll serve now to post five in the black shirt, Argoitia. Rote stays alive and scores, point to the two. So that's four in a row now, right out of the box for Irutia. He will serve to post six in gold, Oyenart. Diving Rebote, big bounce, cut off by Urrutia moving in. He'll shoot it to the backcourt. The Chick Shack scores. Point two. Post seven wearing brown is Oyardi. Inside placement is a winner, point two. So now, six straight points for Urrutia out of post two. It is now possible game point. He will serve the post eight in purple. That is Aron. There's the Chula from Aron, point to the eight. So that stops the six-point run of Urrutia, and eight will now try to turn the corner here as he serves to post one to Colet. Points are double. First to seven will win the game. The diving Robote save. Now moving in, playing it low and hard is Tukule. Shoots back out to the wood and will score point one. So one with the first double point. He will serve now to post three in white, Libois. Off the cesta, point of the one. And one will serve to four, Benetrix. Here's a rebote by Benetrix, and Tukule has it near the sidewall. Stays in play. Low hard one by Tukule. And the rebote save made by Benetrix. Tough catch at the sidewall, Tukule. So post one, Tukule, possible game point now for him with 6 points. He'll serve to post five, Argoitia. Point five. Five, 7-6, Soyanar. Big bounce pulled down by Oyenard. Oyenard takes it forehand this time. He'll send it deep to the inside of the court and Argoitia right there to take it on the reverse. Short hop catch. Nice play, Argoitia. Thank you. Trying for the backhand flip. Unsuccessful, though. It's point of the five. That's 4 points now for Argoitia. He'll serve to post seven and Brown OERD. Point of five. So five with 6 points now, and as it turns out, he'll face the two who ran the first 6 points of the game and is back up to receive. They both have six, so the winner of this point will take the game. This is win point. Off to Sesta, point and game to post two, Urrutia. This will be placed and show point then, one serving to five. The winner places, the loser will show. Tough catch at the sidewall by Argoitia. Big bounce inside this time, pulled down by Tukale. Bote center of the court. Off Tukale sets the point in place to the five. One will show. 2-5-1, your order finish here in the first. Price is now posted for game one. 2-5 Quinella, $36. 2-5 Exacta, $70.40. 2-5-1 Trifecta, $188.20. Game number two is up next. It is a spectacular seven singles match. It completes the daily double. Post time 6 minutes away now. And now just 2 minutes remain for betting on game number two. Post time 2 minutes away. This is last call for betting on game number two. This is last call. Game two is doubles, make that singles, spectacular seven. Singles match played to 7 points with points doubling after the first round of play. Serving and wearing the red shirt, post one is La Lu, receiving in the blue shirt, post two is Zugait. Here's the serve by La Lu, and game two is on. Bote back to the inside. And that one gets by Zugait. First point will go to the one. Wearing white in post three is Arrieta. Arrieta on the outside of the court. And that spins out of the cesta. Point goes to the three. Wearing green, post four, Echeverry. Point three. There's post five in the black shirt, Cabanillas. Two all by Arrieta. That scores, point three. Post six in the gold shirt is Uranga. Excellent carom by Arrieta, point three. That's four in a row for post three, Arrieta, and he'll serve now to post seven in the brown shirt at Tyne. Tipped by Arrieta, point to the seven. Post eight completes the first round of play in purple. It is Vicente. Backhand catch, Vicente, beautiful play. Nice grab on the backhand this time by Vicente. And eight takes final point of the first round. So the first round, all the points were worth one. Now they're all worth two for the remainder of the game. Back in the court is post two, Zugaitis. First to seven will win it. Turn carom. Vicente cannot hang on as he loses his footing. Point to the two. Two now serving to one, Lalu. Thank you. Climbing the sidewall is Zugaitz. Cannot catch it, though, and it's point of the one. One now serving to four. That is Echeverry. There's a two all from the back wall. Carroll return. And that hit the screen. It's a winner before he was able to make the catch. It did go into the screen. So scored for the one. Five points now for Lalu, post one. Trying to stop him is Cabanillas, post five. Center of the court, and that is spins out of the cesta, point and game to post one, Lalu. Three will take second, two will finish third. Winning game number two, post one, Lalu, finishing second, post three, Arieta, coming in third, post two, Zugaitz. Quinella 1-3 is $15.20. The Exacta 1-3, $39 even. The Trifecta 1-3-2, $209.40. And the Daily Double is a 2-1 combination, returning $37.80. Game number three is up next. It is Double Spectacular 7. It is our first Superfecta game of the performance. So this one played with Spectacular 9 scoring. First to 9 wins the game, points doubling after the first round of play. Game number three gets underway in 7 minutes. Good luck. Thanks for being here tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Hope you had a happy Christmas, very Merry Christmas, a happy Hanukkah, Kwanzaa, however you celebrate the holiday. We hope you had a great time. And glad to have you back at Hilai this week. Of course, we do want to let you know that we are open on New Year's Eve, which is Sunday. We do have a matinee performance beginning at 1 p.m. Monday is our dark day, so we will not be open on New Year's Day, but on Sunday evening, after the performance over in the Lux Buffet, very special offer from 6 to 11 p.m. They have a great offer with a carving station of pork loin. Also, main courses include filet mignon, airline chicken, coconut shrimp, and chicken chaufa. Those are the main courses. Plenty of other fixings to go with it, antipasto, salad, soup, side dishes and dessert included. All for only $49.99 per person. That is Sunday night, New Year's Eve, 6 to 11 p.m. We hope you'll join us for that. The Lux Buffet and great highlight in the afternoon on December 31st. Okay, welcome once again to all of our fans out there watching on YouTube. A big crowd out there tonight. Not a lot of response on the chat yet, but we'll see some as we get going. Benny's up in the booth with me, and we're going to have conversations in between several games tonight. We may get back to little Miami Vice a little later on.
Yeah,
but
I was thinking about that on the ride home, and there's still a lot of meat on that bone.
Oh, huge. I think there's a whole roast pig.
Yeah, there's a, you know, again, it was a good time. But actually, I want to start off the night by saying that today is the actual 70th anniversary of this property. December 28th, 1953, the first highlight matches were played here on this court. Well, no, actually it wasn't on this court, on this property. And so I just wanted to celebrate it and just wish everybody a happy 70th.
What do you mean it wasn't this court? Where was the court?
Well, this is the second court. This court was built in 1978. The previous court was right about where Denise is sitting. That was where the side wall was. And so the lower bowl was smaller and the auditorium was smaller. And they were having such large crowds that they were selling out and they felt like they needed to expand. And so what they did was they moved the court back about 100 feet.
Well, they still played on the old one while the new one was being built. They did that at Miami too, I know.
No, I think that they closed. I actually have some photos, and there's a YouTube video that I put together with all the photos from the construction of 1978. So the big red beams that you see on the roof from miles away, that's what ties the old building with the new half of the building, which is the court and the executive building that we're actually sitting in right now. So pretty interesting. I'll try to dig up that that link for the YouTube video so you can see the pictures. It's pretty cool. It's a 1978, you know, construction site, and this actual court was put up, and you could just see the court with no roof, no nothing but the front side and back wall.
Well, I guess at the time when Dania opened, there was only Highline in Miami.
Yes.
Dania opened, and then I think Tampa opened the same year or the
yeah,
year
very,
following.
Yeah, very soon after Tampa opened up. I believe it was in 54 that Tampa opened up. I might be mistaken. It might have been 53, but I know that it was Tampa was the second Fronton in South Florida.
And what do you hear about those days as far as quality of play, maybe how the court was, that sort of thing? What do you
– Well, actually,
I mean, obviously, you weren't born until about 5 years later.
No, yeah, I wasn't born – actually, 11 years later, 64. But the – you know, it looked like a pretty good court. Like, it looked natural from the videos that I've seen. Actually, this morning, I posted a little something. Actually, the story that's in the program about the – 1953 when there was some hiccups in the construction. But I also put a link to a video. It's on Tiger's Chalk Talk for those of you that know it. Click on the link on the bottom and it takes you to a YouTube video that it shows the old court and it shows players on the court. And then there's about a minute of actually somebody standing on the court while the players were throwing the ball around. That was the previous court. That court was knocked down in 1977 or 78.
Was Buddy Hackett here on opening night?
You know, there's a lot of pictures. I inherited like a lot of the marketing stuff when the new company came in and they didn't know what to do with it. And they basically said, hey, we're going to get rid of this stuff. So if you want to go through it. And I went through all of the marketing pieces all the way back, you know, to the 50s. And I inherited this little, it's not a safe, but it looks like a safe, and it has a whole bunch of pictures in it. They're actual photographs, black and white, from all the rosters, all the trophy presentations, all the celebrities that came, Buddy Hackett, Johnny Unitas. There was just a bunch of people that used to come here. Jackie Gleason,
Green, I remember.
Yeah, Lauren Green. They were performing on Miami Beach, and they would come to the property. And everybody was very elegant. We had a butler that would, greet everybody at the door and serve them drinks and things like that. So a lot of good pictures out there. One day when I'm bored and lonely, I'm going to scan some of them, which I already have. I have a lot of them. Either on a site, a Facebook site, or just on my computer drive. But a lot of great pictures from the 50s, 60s, 70s, and even 80s and 90s.
Well, you know, there's people listening right now out there that would pay good money for some of that stuff.
Well, I mean, you know, I always say, well, you know, it's not really for sale. It's just sitting in my garage. But I always say that it doesn't serve anybody for it to just sit in my garage if nobody's going to see it. Like, that's why I would like to upload it to a certain special Facebook page or Instagram or something where people could, you know, point out like, hey, look, there's my grandfather. He used to play at Dania years ago and just things like that.
What is the prognosis then when they opened as to whether it would be able to compete with Miami? Because Miami was well established at that point.
Yeah. Well, I think that they took the attitude right off the bat that it was the premier fronton in the United States. They called it the Palace. And, you know, a lot of the public relations and a lot of the marketing at that time, it seemed from the pieces that I've seen, they weren't even looking at Miami Highlight. They were their own thing, and they felt that it was the best product available.
Well, of course, not like today with all the fast cars and the highways and everything. It was probably tough to get up here from Miami and vice versa.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of pictures, aerial views of the first fronton in the 50s, and there literally is nothing around it. It's all, you know, fields. But it's actually really cool.
It's the tomato patch, known as the tomato patch. Yes. These are all huge tomato grounds and everything. Was there a thought of putting in a hotel at that point? I know there's has been over the years.
I mean, I don't know. I don't think so, but I really honestly don't know. Actually, funny thing, the other day in the audience, I met a guy a little bit younger than me that his great-great-grandfather used to own this land in the 20s, and he ended up gifting it so they could build a casino back in the 20s or 30s, and that never happened. And then, you know, the story was the fronton was built in the 50s. The line looks good. Everybody has got their bets in. The players are waiting. So we'll pick it up. You're here all night, right?
I'm here for the duration.
All right. So I'll be up in and out. If you guys got any questions, just throw them through the chat, and I'll go through them on our break and answer them later.
By the way, if you heard our discussions about Miami Vice last night, we can expand on that. Let us know if you want to hear more stories, because a lot of people probably missed a bunch of that. And we could, like you say, meat on the bone. We could talk probably for several games about that.
Yeah, I'll come up every game, and we'll bang it all out. But also, there was some questions in the matinee yesterday that we never got to because of the Miami Vice thing. So we'll get to that too.
This is game number three. Spectacular. Serving wearing red in post one, Lebois and Cabanillas. Receiving in blue post two, Arrieta and Argoitia.
Game is on. Back corner, tough catch there by Argoitia. Now here's Lebois. Arrieta drops it to the inside. Coming on to get it is Cabanillas. Backpedaling is Libois. Cannot make the Revolte save, though, and it's point to post two. Two serving now, two post three, wearing white, Vicente and the time. Two serving to four in green, Uresti and Zugait. Running it down, shooting the hard throw inside. Is Argoitia, and two will get another. Three straight for the two team. They'll serve now to post five, wearing black, Benetrix and Tukale. Excellent shot by Arrieta, the two-wall winner, point two. Post six in the gold shirts, that is Aron and Oyardi. Thank you. Strong forehand throw to the inside. Tough hop there, but the catch made by Argoitia. And that is off assist at this time, point to the six. So the sixth team on the board now, and they'll serve to post seven, wearing brown, Echeberry, and Labor. There's a tough save right at the sidewall by Aron. Here's the Cortada. Aron with a scoop and the carom. Out to get it out in the wood is Laborde. And a great catch there by Aron. Diving Robote save. Seven takes the point. Here's post eight in purple. That is Urrutia and Oyanar. And we'll stay on the court. Point to post seven. Now points are worth double for the remainder of the game. Back on the court, Libois and Cabanillas in post one. Big bounce is a winner, point of the one. So post one will serve to post three. That is Vicente Anatan. Play there in the backhand by Dubois. Forehand throws into the upper cushion, point of the three. And three will serve to four. Uresti and Zugait. Zugaitz with a reverse into the backcourt. It's caught at the back wall there by a time. And that one will spin out of the cesta with Zugaitz. three will get a double. Three with 4 points now, serving to post five. Benetrix and Tukale. Three with a pair. Don't forget, this is a 9-point game. It takes nine to win. Three will now serve with their 6 points to the two team, returning with four. Here's a two all, and it scores. It's point to the two. So two team now is six, and they'll serve to post six. Aron and Oyard. Catch in the back corner by Oyard. And that is off the cesta. Two will get a pair. Eight points, possible game point. Arieta and Argoitia post two, trying to stop them. The 18, Urrutia and Oyenard, possible game point for the two. Cesta point and game to the two team, Arieta and Argoitia. Three finishing second, playoff now for show and quad positions to complete the try and superfectus. Seven serving to one. The winner will take third, the loser fourth. Too low on the pad, point and show, post seven, one will take quad. 2-3-7-1, your order finish here in tonight's third game. Winning game three, post two, Arieta and Argoitia finishing second to three team, Vicente and Atan coming in third, post seven, Echeberry and Laborde finishing fourth, post one. Lebois and Cabanillas. Quinella 2-3, Exacta 2-3. Trifecta 237, the Super 2371, and your prices are posted. 2-3 Quinella in game number three, $17.60. We'll get back to the exact and try, but the Superfectas, 237-1, $475.90. That is on the $1 ticket. Going back to the exact at 2-3 is $42 even. 237 Trifecta, $236.40. Game four is up next. It is a doubles match played with spectacular seven scoring. Game number four gets underway in 7 minutes.
Back talking to our friends out in YouTube land.
YouTube.
Gotta name that country. YouTube. It's not a good country name. Anyway, Benny's back with me. And before we get back to Miami Vice stuff, I did want to mention there are some questions about Miami Vice, by the way, on the chat, which we'll talk about. But Arrieta winning a couple of games in a row here. I know he's in his, I guess, early 40s. He's by far the oldest player.
I think he just turned 43, I believe.
How does he – I mean, obviously, he's a great guy. He gets along with everybody. He's
the
been
captain.
A leader.
He's the captain.
He's been a leader of the highlight players for a long time. Mm-hmm. Do they give him the due respect for his age?
Yeah, I think that, you know, these young guys, obviously, they all like him. He treats them well while they're here. He shows them around. He takes them out on his boat. He has little get-togethers where everybody, goes and hangs out. Remember, these guys all they have here is each other, but the captain is very facilitating when it comes to getting everybody together on their days off and, always finding stuff for them to do. But, and as far as like, you know, his leadership role, it's a little different now. Like before, he was a representative that was representing a roster of players. And, you know, with that comes a lot of, suggestions, negative comments. There, you know, it has its good and its bad. So while he was representing the crowd, there were their good days and there were the bad days. With this group, it's a little different. He plays a backseat role when it comes to asking questions and finding things out. He and I have a great relationship as far as back when he was the union representative and now. I think now nothing really has changed personally, but I think that we get along a lot better now because we just kind of keep everything on the surface.
Well, we talk about Basque people, great laid-back people, nice, polite, but stubborn. And I should say that Arrieta fits into that. He's not afraid to say what he thinks. Do that.
I'll even go as far as to say he loves to argue. He really does love to argue with. I mean, there have been times where we've had conversations that would lead into an argument, and I've often told, and this was long ago, nothing recently, but I would often tell him, I'm not arguing with you about this. I'm going to tell you how I feel, or I tell you what I think, or I'm going to tell you what has to be done, and we're not going to argue about it. There is a large group of the players that have played here in the past that are like that. And they, you know, they'll sit back there and you think it's an argument. And you think that soon someone's going to get punched, but it never turns into that. It's just a heated debate or discussion. And it's always a lot of fun to listen to, you know. With the French guys, it's a little different because you see the same thing. You just don't know what they're talking about. And there it sometimes looks like blows are going to about to happen, but never do. So.
Well, we might have to get back to the Miami Vice stuff in the next game, but there are a couple of questions not about that.
Right.
One was about any thoughts of retiring Eric's number. Or maybe
I saw that. I saw that, and I'll address it. I mean, look, he was a great player by – you know, probably historically the best player that played here as far as accomplishments, singles, doubles, most wins, triple crowns. And yes, I have thought of retiring his number. along with Egerbide's number, along with, you know, maybe a Waristi's number. There are players that have played here in the past that are deserving of retiring their numbers. Now, right now, the person wearing number 11 is wearing it in honor of his father winning, wearing that number when he played here in the 90s. And some will argue that Atain Sr. was one of the best backcourters that has ever played at Dania. So I'm not saying that I won't retire Eric's number or number 11 for Eric because of Atain or because his son is wearing it now, but it is definitely a factor in the whole decision.
Well, another question comes from Chris A., who has been one of our longest fans.
Yeah, Chris, how are you doing out there?
From the very beginning of Tigers Chalk Talk, and always polite and nice to me. So
I think he was here recently.
A little shout-out to him. Thanks for being on the chat tonight. He asks if any of the players are adjusting to a new position, and they're asking a person who did adjust to a new position.
Yeah, no, I don't – as far as I know, everybody that's playing now the position that they're playing here at Dania, they've always played it. I mean, I can't think of any of the backcourters that switched from the back or from the front to play in the back and vice versa. But there was someone practicing, a special guest, not special, but he's special to me. That's Gorka Sorozabal, is visiting from France. And he actually has always been a backcourter, but he really wanted to come play here. And I didn't have a spot in the backcourt. So I told him, I said, look, you want to play, you can play for a couple of weeks or months in the front court. And he did it, and he was miserable. He didn't like it at all. He was kind of lost up there. But in time, because he took that position, there was an opening that he was able to slide into in the backcourt.
Of course, the son of the Sorozabal that played up in Connecticut for many years.
Correct.
And the brother of?
Of Johan.
Of Johan,
which is actually one of the top players over there in the Basque Country right now.
Another question was about that opening night. You mentioned the date. You knew the date. Now you got homework to do. You
yes,
got to go back and look at the attendance.
4,700.
Wow. You knew that in offhand.
Well, it was in the story that I posted on Tiger's site. It said that the opening night was about – it was either 42 or 4,700. I'm going to go with 4,700 and change. But, yeah, it was just under 5,000 people were here for the opening night in 1953.
Well, if it's anything like today's, the next night was probably half of that.
and someone here says, "What about a fan of pre?" There's about 8 or 10 people in line, so we'll do another 45 seconds or so. Let Denise get these bets in. Someone said about doing something later on in the season about fan appreciation night, and you know, have some retired players here to take some pictures and things like that. I've thought about it often, and quite frankly, if you show up on any Friday night, it is like a retired players get together. I mean, here this past Friday night, there was probably 35 to 40 retired players in the audience. Players from Tampa, players from Orlando, players from West Palm Beach, players from Dania, from Miami. So there were players from all. Arriaga was here. Both Arriagas were here. Rufino was here. There was a number of players that would love to, you know, say hello and shake your hand and take a picture. So would I consider it? Maybe. I don't think it would be any more special than any other Friday night.
And one quick question. William asks about the highlight trading cards. Will you do that again? And what was the response to the first year? Because they turned out spectacular.
Yeah, we had a good response. We did a couple of giveaways, and we were going to do something with Joey, and we were going to do like a fan appreciation night. And I have like 100 Joey player trading cards. I gave him 100. I have about 100. And because of COVID, we had to scrub it. So we're thinking about it. The biggest challenge is getting the photos. You know, the easier part is creating the cards and purchasing them. So we're definitely considering it. It's always something that's in the works. It's just a matter of somebody named Benny finding the time to do it.
And it's always true that people love getting get-togethers. A couple years ago when we thought maybe Dania was closing for good, we had a tremendous amount of players that night.
Yeah. That was a sad get-together, but it was very well attended.
Do you hope to do that again?
Yeah. Not pretending like we're closing to get people out here. No. We'll just hope that everybody that loves Dania and supports it and really enjoys what they're seeing now just shows up the last couple of weeks of February to celebrate not just the last semifinal and the final partido, but the trophy presentation as well.
And one quick question.
Yeah.
The players that have been coming out, what have their comments been to you about the quality of these guys?
They love it. Everybody, I have not had one complaint, even about the players that are a little green and not really performing as well as the others. Not one negative comment about any of the players. Everything has been positive. These guys are young. They're energetic. They're hungry. They're trying their hardest out there, and they really want to qualify for a top seed in these partidos. So they're giving it all, and it ends this Sunday. So I think this weekend's going to be pretty tight.
And we'll be mentioning those points a little bit later so you can follow it online. Let's get to game four. Three great games so far, and one more to come here.
This is game four tonight, spectacular. Seven doubles match, played to 7 points, points doubling after round one. Serving and wearing red in post one will be Aron and Danel. Receiving in blue post two, Chenika and Oyenar. Here's the serve by Aron, and the game is on. Wearing the one. Wearing white, post three, here's Uresti and Tukale. Out of play, point three. Three will serve to four in green. That is Lalu and Argoitia. Out of the inside, and it's caught by Lalu. Tipped in the back corner by Tukale. Scored for the four team. Four now serving to five. They wear black. It's Urrutia and Uranga. Yeah. Strong throw to the inside. There's the catch on the forehand. Here's Oranga again now. He'll play the reverse. Out it comes. Lalu, left side, Rabote. Point four. Four will serve to six, wearing the gold shirts, Benetrix and Laborde. And four, we'll get another. Here's the 17 in brown, that is Lebois and Leke. Point of four. Four serving to post eight in purple, that's Jagoba and Oyardi. There's reverse by ORD. Hortada the inside, and that is a winner. Nice shot there by Lalu. Point four. So the four team with five straight points. They'll try to turn the corner here and run the perfect game. They'll serve it. Two post two, Chanika and Oyenard. Possible perfect game point for the four. Costalo over the head of Argoitia, scored for the two. And now two will serve to one. That is Aron and Danel. Here's to Karam for a winner, point one. One serving to three, Uresti and Tukale. Another carom, this one. Aron gets to, but cannot hang on when he does. It's point of the three. And post three will start to post five, Urrutia And Oranga. Remate winner by Urrutia, 0.5. And 5 will serve to 6, Benetrix and Laborde. Remate winner. Service error, point to the 6. And now here's the 7 team, that is Libois and Leke. That's out of play up in the side wall. Score for the 6. Here is post 8. That is Yagoba and Oyard. It's out of play on the return. Dejada, 1-6. Moving into position to receive the 14. Back with their 5 points they earned the first time up. The 6 has 6, so this will now be win point. 6-74, the winner takes the game. Great catch and a forehand there by Laborde. And that's out of the Cesta point and game to post 6. So the 4 team loses the point, but they'll take second place. And this will now be show point at post 1, serving to post 3. This is show point. There's the inside placement. Moving up to get it is Donnell. Strong forehand throw to the backcourt, and on the run, there's Tukele. Point One in show, post one. Your order finish here in game number four tonight is 6-4-1. Results are now official. 6-4-1, your order finish. The 4-6 Quinella, $44. 6-4 Exacta, 130 even. 6-4-1 Trifecta, $268 even. Game number five is next. It is a singles match as we reach the halfway point of tonight's performance. Make your selections and place your bets now. Post time in 8 minutes for game number five.
We're back in between games here, and since we teased it so hard, let's get back to a little Miami Vice discussion. There was one more question about that on the chat about was there any other thought of using someone besides Alorio for the opening montage, and obviously that wasn't our call.
Right.
I don't know where they got the footage, but it was a great shot, and I don't believe they changed the opening credits, the song, or the footage
ever
at all never. During the series.
Right. I mean, as long as I can remember, Elorio was in the first opening scene of Miami Vice. I don't think so. Somebody said here in the chat, I didn't see it, but Mike told me he saw it, that somebody was asking what Tico was whispering as he was dying to Don Johnson. You remember? I remember. He said,
I didn't hear. I wasn't on the court, I don't
Isabel
believe.
Isabel Batista. Isabel Batista. And then he said something else like,
who was the lady who had him killed?
It was the lady that was framing her brother in the episode to, that she had the tape. Isabel Batista, the tape. She had a tape that showed how the prostitute was not killed by him.
And that was so long ago. That was a VHS tape.
Yeah, it was a VHS. Actually, I have the episode on a VHS tape. I don't have a VCR, though.
I saw you did post it on the chat, so if you want to scroll back up and you want to get a link to
the link to...
Is that the entire show or just a portion?
I don't know. Mike was the one that posted the link, but I believe that it is the episode. It's either on YouTube or something like that.
Mike told me he had looked at something earlier, and it was the scene that contained you.
Oh, so it's just a the clips, just the highlight clips.
But if anyone wants to watch the whole show, it is on DVD.
Yes.
Season 3.
Episode 3, Kill Shot.
Right.
Season 3. A couple of fun facts about the episode. So in the locker room scene, where we talked about it a little bit yesterday, where the guy slammed Dara for 10 or 12 times against the locker, I had a speaking part. Now, when I was getting ready for that scene, before we did the first take, they said, you know, we don't want everybody just like in their uniform, so do you have like something you could wear over your uniform? And I got Soroa in his locker had the jacket that World High Alai used to give out years ago that said High Alai on the front. And it was a red jacket with the letters in the front that said High Alai with the little, I guess it was the World High Alai logo. So I get the jacket and I walk in, and right away, like at the corner of my eye, I see this lady running towards me. And she's like, no, you cannot wear that jacket. We're not allowed the wardrobe. And nothing red. Nobody can wear red. There can't be red in the background. It's against the colors. And I said, well, okay. So I take it off. So as I'm taking it off, the director or the producer, Leon Echasa, comes up to me and says, keep it on. I like it. So long story short, I kind of broke history in that series. I'm the only person that has ever worn anything red in Miami Vice.
If they ever do another show, they'll have to make pink jackets.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, well, you know, that's like we said yesterday, the Art Deco movement came from the show Miami Vice.
Another fun fact was the scene where it's a nightclub, like a strip club.
Yeah.
And there was plenty of that was done upstairs in the locker room.
Yep.
Outside the basket room and the ballroom, and they made it look so real.
Right, and also in the back of in the players' parking lot, they kind of dressed that up as the entrance to the club, and then the actual nightclub was the upstairs of the locker room, which was kind of like our players' lounge, and then the dressing room where one of the dancers was being questioned by one of the Vice cops. Was the ballroom. And yeah, they came in super early that day, probably 7-8 in the morning, and they started like, you know, like these people that just build sets, and they just dressed everything up, and it looked exactly. If you didn't know, you wouldn't know.
Talk about that shooting schedule, because people don't realize there's a lot of standing around. It's kind of boring.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
you gotta hurry up and wait. You shoot a scene for 30 seconds and then you wait an hour.
Yeah.
But they came early in the morning. I think all the shooting at High Alai was done on 2 days.
Yeah, I think it was two days, and it was consecutive 7 a.m. to like 11 p.m. all day long. We were there all day for 2 days. And yeah, we did a lot of scenes, and then we did a lot of retakes, and then we did a lot of other angles from the same scene. So yeah, it was a lot of standing around, but for me, it was kind of fun. You know, it wasn't like wasted time, because every time that we had a break and we sat down, somebody interesting, or at least interesting to me, would come over and talk to me and want to talk about High Alai, or want to talk about, you know, playing High Alai or the game. So it was always fun. You know, like some of the guys I mentioned, you know, Don Johnson, I talked to him for, you know, several times for, you know, probably 20, 30 minutes a time.
And he gave you a coconut popsicle.
He did. He gave me a coconut popsicle. I loved it. Never had one again after that, by the way, just for the record. I was one and done. Fernando Allende, super nice guy. The other guy, Carlos Sestero, all of them. The only person that I didn't even talk to, wasn't even allowed to approach him, was Philip Michael Thomas.
And he was pretty cool against talking to people, I think.
Yeah, he had two bodyguards. Idea. He had two bodyguards that would block him from everybody at all times. Like, he would walk on the scene but behind two of his bodyguards that would just stand there, and he would do the scene. He would turn around, the bodyguards would follow him out, and he wouldn't talk even to like the other cast members. It was really strange.
I don't remember him ever doing many things after Miami Vice was over. I know Don Johnson was on Nash Bridges and a few other shows, but I don't remember Philip Michael Thomas really having a prolific acting career.
No, I think that was pretty much the end of it for him. But anyway, we'll pick this up, I guess, a little later on. Shoot some more questions. Me and Dave are going to be here all night long. I wish we were on camera, because he's donning a vintage Post 6 Dania High Alai shirt, number 45. And we were not arguing, but we were discussing who was 45. I remember Felix coming here for not a season, but for a couple of months, and he wore number 45. So anybody out there in the chat want to dispute that or want to add their 2 cents, we'd be glad to hear it. Oh, and one last thing. Our friend Mr. Diamond from Connecticut will be here in a couple weeks. And looking forward to seeing you, brother. Let me know when you're here, and I'll come out and say hello.
This is game number five. It is a singles match, spectacular seven. Serving wearing red in post one, Sugaitz receiving in blue post two, Vicente. There's the serve. Game five is on. First point, we'll go to the one. Wearing the white shirt to post three is Laborde. And a carom. We'll score. Point of the one. Point of the four. Four now serving to post five, wearing the black shirt, it's Arrieta. Arrieta de la Remate, running it down on the outside is Atain, but the throw gets away from him and hits the cushion. It's point to the five. Five will serve to six in gold. That is Echeverri. Two all, we'll score, 1-5. 0-7, wearing the brown shirt is Cabanillas. Too hard into the sidewall and it lands off the court. It's point to the seven. Uresti wears purple post eight. He completes round one. That one's out of play. Above the cushion. Scored for the seven. So the seven with 2 points, and he'll serve now to post to Vicente. Points are worth double. First to seven wins this singles game. That is an underserve, point of the two. That's too low into the cushion. Three, we'll get a double. Three serving to post one. Zugaitz, he's back with 2 points. On the outside, there's the catch on the wood. And the hard throw inside is a winner for Zugaitz. Point of the one. And one now serving to post four a time. And that carom lands on the wood, point of the one. Possible game point. Post one, Zugaitz serving to Echeberry. Post six. Strong throw, deep. That is a tremendous catch by Zugaitz, but his return will fall short as he was off balance on the throw, point to the six. Six, serving to five, Arrieta. That's an overserve. Point of the five. Five will serve to post eight. Uresti. Point five. No interference ruled there because the judges determined there was no chance for him to get over to the sidewall to make that catch. 6 points now, possible game point for Arrieta in post five. Serves to post seven. Thank you. Pulling down the big bounce is Cabanillas, and that one's touched by Arrieta, point to the seven. So that will bring back the two, Vicente. There's a Robote inside. Cabanillas cannot hang on. Point to the two. Two will serve to three, Laborde. Comes low off the back wall, a winner for the two. So the two now with 6 points. Possible game point for Vicente. He will serve to a tine. Post four. Two all by Vicente, point and game to post two. Place and show point now as one serves to five. This will be for place and show. Forehand throw. Now Arrieta comes over the top with a big bounce, climbing the sidewall, making the play, Zugaitz. This time he goes for the scoop on the forehand. Here's a Dejada. Here comes Arrieta. He's there. The carom will score. It's point of place to the five, and one will show. Two, five, one, your order finish here in game five. Winning the fifth, post two, Vicente finishing second to five, Arrieta coming in third, post one, Zugaitz. Quinella 2-5, Exacta 2-5, the trifecta 2-5-1. Two, five, Quinella, $10 even. 2-5 exact to 26, even. Trifecta 120-180 for the 2-5-1. And you pick three numbers, 2-6 and 2. 3 of 3 gets back $243 even. Game six is up next. It is double spectacular nine scoring. Win, place, show, Quinella, Exacta, Trifecta, and the Big Pink Superfecta. Also, the pick four starts here. Pick four starts here in game six. Thank you.
Okay, Benny's back up with us here, and he's going to talk a little bit about the tournament that's been going on season long. I guess no real late drama on who's going to make the partidos, because Dave told me last night that he thought that the eight fronts and backs were kind of determined, maybe not the exact order, but it all ends this Sunday. So talk about how you score it, who's doing the best, and what we can expect from the partidos.
Well, the scoring is 5 points for a win, 3 points for a place, and 1 point for a show. And all games count, both singles and doubles. And if your partner, obviously, it doesn't matter what partner you play with. If you play with the same guy or you play with different partners, you still get the 5 points, 3 points, one. And it's not split. But doing the best pretty much the whole tournament, Atain has been in the lead in the backcourt. Urrutia, he's been in the lead, but Vicente is either really close behind him all the time, or I think in a couple of instances he was in first place. But I'll do a real quick rundown. If it were to end today, right now, which it doesn't, it ends Sunday after game nine, you would have in first place at this moment in the front court, it's Urrutia with 216 points, and first place in the back court is Atain with 221 points. So if it were to end today, they would be the number one seed, and they would play next Friday night, a week from tomorrow. Also, in second place, you have Vicente with 210 points, and in the backcourt, you have Laborde with 206 points. So right now, if it ended, they would be the second seed, and they would play a little bit further down the line. We have the bracket that maybe Mike could put the bracket up so you could see the dates and who plays against who. In third place right now in the front court, number 13, Benetrix with 191 points. And in third place in the back court, number 96, Oyenard with 152. Oyenard is actually tied with 152 points with Danel, which also has 152 points. But Oyenard has most wins, more wins. In fourth place in the front court, you got Chanika with 182. And again, Danel with 152 in the back. So they would be the fourth seed if it ended today. We have Arietta in fifth place with 181. So he's 1 point behind Chanika. He could sneak up and take fourth place. But right now he's in fifth. And OIRD is in fifth place with 145 points. With 175 points, you have Uresti in sixth place in the front court. And in sixth place in the back court, you have Zugaitz with 143. Jagoba in seventh place in the front court with 163 points. And in the back court, seventh place is held by Uranga with 141. And Aaron rounds up the front court in eighth place right now with 151 points. And Argoitia with 140 points is in eighth place. Now, if you take a quick look here at the standings that Mike just put up were not updated. Those are from yesterday. But the standings I have in front of me here now, in fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth place in the backcourt, OIRD has 145, Zugaitz has 143, Uranga has 141, and Argoitia has 140. So they're all within 5 points. Fifth place and eighth place are only 5 points away, so that could definitely change. And only 7 points ahead of OIRD, you have Oyenard and Danel with 152. So in reality, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth place can change from here to Sunday afternoon.
Is there a singles aspect to the competition at all?
Well, there is as I mentioned, the 5 points, 3 points, 1 points is both singles and doubles. Now, aside from that, which we haven't really talked about a lot about because we're mainly focused right now on the qualifying in the month of December and the partido starting in January, but we are having a singles championship, which is all singles games, the first, second, fifth, and ninth game, and the tenth game on Saturday night. Those all count as one win. It's going to be whoever has the most wins in all singles games combined will be the singles champion. So you'll see a guy like Arietta or Leke playing game one, and you'll see a guy like Cabanilla or one of OIRD playing game nine. There is no early and late like there used to be. So we kind of I kind of shift them around in a rotation. So not only do they play all four or five of the singles matches, but they also play against everybody on the roster, not just the same guys over and over.
Is there any maybe a couple of guys who are like best friends from the same town that would love to play in the tournament? I mean, it's not something you could really arrange, obviously.
Well, it's pretty difficult, but out of the whole group, I would say that Arietta mentioned to me the other day that Argoitia is his nephew, and he would really like to play. And as a matter of fact, he had considered retiring last season, but when he found out that Argoitia was going to come here to play these 3 months, he decided to hang out one more season so he could have the opportunity to play with him. And they would love to play the tournament together, but right now Argoitia would have a lot of work. Not really a lot of work to do. He would just have to, as a matter of fact, if he wins this game and the next game, he's right there. Or if he gets a first place and a second or a third, he's right there.
So by my powers of deduction, that means that Arietta is related to Javier, the famous Javier.
Yes, he is, but I wouldn't be able to tell you how. I know that I'm almost sure it's on his mother's side, but I don't know how the relationship, the family tree works there.
Has it been as gratifying for you this year? It turned out so well last year. We had some great partidos.
Yeah.
A couple of 15-14 games with Zuleika
and
I forget, Goichari, I think, was in one of them. But are you looking forward to the partidos again?
Yeah, I think that it's where we're going to see these younger players shine. They're not used to playing Canelas. They don't play Canelas. We still have about 10 people in line, by the way, so it's going to be a few minutes, or a minute at least. So these guys are playing Canelas for the first time, and I think that their whole life they've played either partidos to 30 or 35 or sets to 15, two sets to 15. So they're not really used to playing and sitting and playing and sitting. So I think that some of them are going to show a different aspect of their game in a 15-point match.
Is that so? There's no Canelas over there at all?
Well, the younger guys, I think they do play Canelas just for the sake of the competition and, you know, more players playing at the same time. But for the most part, their main format is partidos, until recently that they went to two sets with a tiebreaker if needed.
And the partido schedule again, Fridays and Saturday nights, an added game?
No, it's just Friday nights. It'll be game 10 of every Friday night from January 6th all the way to February 23rd, being the final match, which is to 21 points. All the other partidos are to 15 points.
Looking forward to it. Like I say, last year was great. I definitely will be here for a lot of them, I'm sure, and I may come out especially just to sit in the audience because it is fun watching from out there.
Yeah. Last year we had more veterans, and I think that showed not only in the tournament qualifying but also in the finals. But I think that this time, really honestly, it's anybody could win it. Anybody seeded from 1 to 8 could win a couple of partidos. You only need to win 4 to win it all. So, you know, when looking at the first seed and the eighth seed, they're not that far apart in talent. So I think that Uruti and Vicente maybe have the upper hand in the front court. And Atain, Laborde, and Oyenard, which are the top three, I think that those guys have shown the most during the qualifying. But again, a partido is a partido, and you could miss two or three balls and lose the lead and lose the game.
Do you think, last question for you, do you think this kind of action, including the partidos, is conducive to these players developing their game while they're here?
Well, that for me is the objective, to invite them here when they're young prospects, to have them learn how to play, not only, you know, partidos or highlight in general, but Canela style, and to grow from it. And I'm hoping that everybody, when they finish in February, is that much better and gets opportunities in the summer to play partidos and tournaments over there and then come back. Like, if you look at a player like Uresti, to me, Uresti has matured so much from last January to this January. Like, he's doubled in his play, in his demeanor, in his attack. Everything has gotten better. So that's my hopes for everybody else, is that they learn and develop from coming here once a year.
Well, you're in touch with the people who run the games over there, Eggy and his brother and, you know, Atain and some of those. They got to be thrilled with his kids getting a chance to do this.
Yeah, they're. I'm sure they're not watching live because right now it's like 3 in the morning over there. But I'm sure they wake up early in the morning and watch the games. All right, we got the green light from Denise. We'll pick this up after this game. And if anybody has some questions, I'm sorry. I didn't even look at the chat during this chat. So after the next game, we'll answer some questions.
This is game number 6. Superfect game, spectacular 9 scoring. Serving wearing red in post 1. Benetrix and Argoitian receiving in blue post 2. Lebois and Cabanillas. First point of the 2. Catching a backhand by Lebois. That one jams him though inside of a cesta, point 3. 3 serving out of post 4, green, that's Yagoba and Oyardi. That one's out of play. 1-3. Post 5 in the black shirts, Aron and Oyenar. Point 3. Here's the 6th team wearing the gold shirts. That is Urrutia and Tukale. Taking the serve, throwing Costado. It's dug out in the backcourt by Donnell. Now the Dejada. And that will drop in for a winner, point 6. Six will serve to the 7 team. Wearing the brown shirts, it's Vicente and Uranga. Point to the seven. 7-7-8 in purple. That is Chinika and Leke. Low, hard reverse to the inside. By Vicente is the winner, point to the seven. Here's the one team returning to receive. It's Benetrix and Argoitia, points are now double. First to nine will win this super effective game. Hanging on in the back court is Argoitia. And one will take a double. One with 2 points now, serving to post two with one. That is Lebois and Cabanillas. Remate will score off the serve, point of the two. The post two will serve to post four, Jagoba and Oyardi. Dehana by Yagoba. Point of the four. We're serving to five. Aron and Oyedar. Big bounce off the Cesta, point of four. Four serving to three. Lalu and Nanel. And two bounces on the serve, point of the four. That gives the four team 6 points, but don't forget, it does take nine to win this game. Back in the court, set to receive post six, Urrutia and Tukale. Moving up to get it. Nice play there made by Oyardi. Lalu the Robote clips the sidewall, heads outside, and there to make the catch is Tukale. Yagoba back to the inside. Out of play, too high. Point of four. 14 with eight possible game point. Yagoba and Oyard. They'll serve the post of eight. Janika and Leke. Now the Robote save made by Chanika. Nice catch by Leke. Now center of the court with a forehand. And that one is caught by Chanika at the sidewall. RD lifts the reverse into the back corner. It's cut off by Leke before it gets there. Big bounce. Pulled down by Leke. And that's off the tip of the cesta. Eight will get a double. And that will keep the game alive. Eight serving out of post seven. Vicente and Uranga. One of the eight. Eight will serve to one. Benetrix and Argoitia.
Four.
Excellent catch at the sidewall by Benetrix. Eight with a double. Point to post eight. Eight points now for the 18, Chanika and Lekade. Possible game point. They will try to get past Aron and Oyenard. They are scoreless. Still a force to be reckoned with, though. Possible game point for the eight. And that one is on the wood. Pointing game, post eight. The four team will finish second. This will be show and quad point. Three serves to two. The winner takes third. The loser will finish fourth. Show and quad. This one comes back out. There's Lalu with a rebote. Too high, though. Hits the upper choppa. Point and show. Post two and three will take the fourth place. 8-4, 2-3. Your order finish here in the sixth game. Winning game six, post eight, Chanika and Leke finishing second to four. Yagoba and Oyard coming in third, post two. Lebois and Cabanillas and finishing fourth to three, Lalu and Danel. Kinella 4-8, exact 8-4, trifecta 8-4-2, superfecta 8-4-2 and 3. And here come your prices for game number six. 4-8 Kinella, 38-60. 8-4 exacta, 53-40. 8-4-2 trifecta, 250-20. Superfecta, 8-4-2 and 3, $998.50. And the $1 ticket, your 10-cent price, $99.85. Game number seven is up next. It is double, spectacular seven scoring. Game number seven is now 8 minutes away. Make your selections, place your bets. Don't wait till the last second, take that chance of getting shut out. Post time will be in 8 minutes. Again, we want to remind you, ladies and gentlemen, about our holiday schedule here. The first is a Monday. We are dark on Mondays, so there will be no New Year's Day performance this year. However, we will be open on Sunday afternoon, which is New Year's Eve. We will not be open in the evening for High Live, but we will be open with the casino, and also Lux with a very special offer. Check out the signs on the second floor there by the Lux entrance. You'll see that there'll be champagne toast at the Sunrise Bar stage if you purchase the Lux Buffet New Year's Eve dinner. They're on sale for $49.99. Includes all the fixings, carving station of pork loin, also several main courses to choose from, and lots of sides and desserts as well. $49.99 per person. Make your reservations, get them in early. That's the New Year's Eve special dinner on Sunday night from 6 p.m. to 11 p.m. We'll have Halei in the afternoon. Of course, we'll have the casino open as well, poker room as well. So check that all out this weekend as we celebrate the new year.
Benny's been checking out the family relationships of the roster, and he's going to give you a few ideas here on things that you are interested in.
We had talked about the great Javier, which, by the way, he was probably one of the smoothest catchers in the history of the game. When I was a ball boy in 1980.
And then went on to Tampa for a great career.
Right. Yes, he played Miami High Line in the 80s, late 70s, 80s, and I was the ball boy, and I was just in awe at how he was really the only player that when he caught with the left side, you couldn't even hear the ball going into the basket. He was so smooth. But anyway, so Javier is Arrieta's uncle. His wife is Arrieta's dad's sister. Okay, so stay with me here. And then Ortsi, which is Argoitia that is playing here now, number 56, is Arrieta's cousin's son.
Ortsi is his nickname?
Ortsi is his name.
His real name.
Ortsi Aldizabal Argoitia. So Javier is his uncle. Javier's wife is Arrieta Sr.'s sister. And Ortsi is the son of Arrieta's cousin. So I hope everybody got that. I know it was confusing for me to read, so I can imagine how confusing it was for everybody to understand. Anyways, let's look and see if there's any questions here, Dave. You have any?
People are wondering if Bolivar has ever tuned into the feed.
You know, that's a great question. I honestly don't know. I don't know Bolivar that well. I know that he lives in a small town, probably named Bolivar, right out of. I just got a text message that says that the great Javier is actually landing at MIA right now as we speak, and he'll be here in town until January 16th. So if anybody knows him and wants to come say hello, it's a great photo op with the great Javier.
I know everyone comes out to check out their nephews or friends. I remember Pedroso came out last year to check out Sorosabal's sons.
Yes.
A few other guys have come, you know, obviously Zuleika II has been here many times, and Zuleika I came out to check out John. I guess he'll be here, and a big thrill for him to see him play at Dania Highline.
Yeah, imagine that. You know, I mean, I long for the day where I get to see my grandson playing at any Fronton, for that matter. A little earlier in the chat, I'm trying to find it here. It was
about
probably
the Hall of Fame?
A couple of games ago where somebody had asked me to give a shout out to a player that used to play here in Dania. I believe it was in the 70s, named Sarah, S-A-R-A. He is in Durango, Spain, and he loves to tune in. So, Sarah, bienvenido. It's nice to have you watching the games, whether you watch them live or the next morning while you're having your coffee. I think it said something about 70th birthday. So my question is the birthday actually on December 28th, 1953?
Wow, that would be too weird.
That would be a great coincidence to see that. This player that played here in the 70s was actually born the same day as Dania Highline was.
Someone asked about the Hall of Fame because there's so many sports that have Hall of Fame members, people that are selected to be honored that way. Obviously, we've had rooms where we've had a lot of memorabilia up, and we called it the Hall of Fame. But as far as selecting players to be recognized above their peers, we've never had that in Highline, have we?
Not that I know of. I mean, actually, there isn't. But some of the Frontons in the in the Basque Country. I know that Markina and I think Guernica also, they have their own little museums featuring players or excellent players that have excelled from those towns or from those frontons, in those frontons. But an actual Hall of Fame, like in Cooperstown or Ohio, the Football Hall of Fame, I don't think that there is anything in Hialeah like that. You know, the same way there's no Hialeah rule book. There is no rule book if you have a question or a interpretation of a rule in the game of Hialeah. There's actually nowhere where you could look it up and you know, confirm or deny what you're thinking about that certain rule.
Someone asked, is Hereche related to Beharéche?
As far as I know, no. They're both French, so they have that going for them. But I don't believe that they are related. They might be from the same town. I don't know that either. But they might be, but I doubt it. I don't think so.
And I think you explained it, but someone asked about the when does the standing start for the singles part of the competition. You want to clarify that again?
Yeah, the singles competition is throughout the whole 3 months. So every game in the singles happens. In addition to that, which I didn't get to because we ran out of time, there is also this season going to be a most wins competition. So the winner of most wins, first, second, and third, will have prize money, as well as singles, first, second, and third. And somebody yesterday in the chat asked about the prize money in the tournament for this season. It's a total pool of 15,000. I want to say it's 3, 2, 1, 5,000, 3,000, 2,000, 1,000 for fourth this year that we added, because Dave Lamont was upset that fourth place didn't get a prize last year. So I think they're getting either $1,000 or $500 to split. And then it's $1,000. $750 and $500 for both the singles and the most wins competition.
And speaking of getting paid, let's backtrack a little bit to Miami Vice again. Yeah. You mentioned that you got checks in the beginning were close to $1,000 in the royalties. What about for the time you spent shooting the show? Did you get paid for that?
Well, no, it was just one pay for the whole thing. I think that the other players that were in it, I think they got like $200 or $250 per the day. But since I had a speaking part, my daily fee was a little bit higher.
Well, down the road we can talk about other movies and shows that were shot at Hialeah, because there were a few.
You know, it's funny because I was just about to say we actually should touch on the Jackass episode that we filmed at Miami Hialeah. That's one of my claim to fames. I get calls at 4 o'clock in the morning from friends saying, hey, I just saw Jackass, you were on it. It's like, yeah, I know, it's like 30 years old, but and how I met Johnny Knoxville for the first time.
I know they did that episode of The Glades. There was one called, the movie called The Take.
Yes. The Glades was here.
The Glades was here at Dania, right? Yeah. And then there was a couple other things. Anyway, if people haven't caught those, you can always catch a lot of that stuff.
Yeah, there was a couple other ones. What was that? The Burn Notice did an episode here. That was really funny. That was a fun time. Anyways, the line seems to be down and the players seem to be ready. Let's get game 7 started. We'll come back for game 8, and then after that, I got to go do some administrative duties.
Okay.
This is game 7. It is a doubles match. Spectacular 7 scoring. It starts the pick 3. Serving and wearing red in post 1, Oresti and Leke. Receiving in blue post 2, Aron and Oyardide. Oyardide. Game seven is on. And that one's out of play. Point of the one. One now serving to the three team wearing the white shirts, Yagoba and Oyanar. Inside, Dehada is a winner by Yagoba, point of the three. Three will serve to four in green, Chanika and Danel. There's a Cortali inside by Yagoba and a catch in the backcourt, Danel. Strong throw, deep to the backcourt and backpedaling and making the catch. Oyanart. There's the carom by Yagoba, point three. Three now serving to post five, wearing the black shirts, Echeberry and Labor. Cortada the inside of the court and it scores, point five. So five will serve to the sixth team in gold. It's out of yet then a time. Arieta drops in a two-wall, and that's a winner. Point of six. That will bring out the seventh team. They wear brown. It's Urrutia and Tukule. Karam off the serve by Urrutia, point seven. Most eight in the purple shirts, Libois and Zugaitz. Fostalo right at Tukele. Tipped in the back wall, point seven. Tejada hits the chopper, scored for the seven. 7 now, 7-1. That's Uresti and Leke. Leaping catch at the back wall by Zugait. Make that Leke. The inside de Hada though by Urrutia scores, point of the seven. So just like that, it's now possible game point for the seven team, Urrutia and Tukele. With their 6 points, they'll serve to the four, Chanika and Danel. Point four. And four will serve to three. That is Yagoba and Oyanar. That carom is too low in the pad by Yagoba, point of the four. Point of four. Six points for the four teams serving out of post six, Sarieta and a time. Arieta grabs it on the reverse. Yeah. for Todd Ansah. That's the winner. Point and game to post four. 7 finishing second. Post 3 will take third. And here come your prizes for game 7, the winning team, post 4. Chanika and Danel finishing second, post 7. Urrutia and Tukale coming in third, post 3. Yagoba and Oyenard. Kinella 4-7, Exacta 4-7, Trifecta 4-7-3. And your prizes, 4-7 Kinella, $60.80. 4-7 Exacta, 303 even, 473 trifecta, 50240. Game number 8 is up next. It is a doubles match played with spectacular 7 scoring. Starts the late daily double. Make your selections. Place your bets now. Post time at 7 minutes. Okay, we're looking at some questions here on YouTube, and one person was asking about Highline merchandise. We have had it in the past. I know that in the past we've had hoodies, we've had hats, we've had a few things, but I guess we have nothing right now.
No, everybody wants some, but for whatever reason, it was I don't know. I have my opinion. I think that it's worth having. It's worth selling. I think it's free advertising for Dania, and I also think that the people love it. I've spoken to several customers that have come here and were disappointed that there wasn't any. But here's what you need to do, everybody. Anybody that wants to, and it's not just about the merchandise, any suggestions, any, I don't want to say complaints. Complaints is not the right word, but if you have a concern that you want to air out, you could always send an email to info@daniacasino.com. That is received by several people in the marketing department, in the food and beverage department. I get it sometimes. I usually get it forwarded to me when it concerns Highlight. But if you really, really want merchandise and you want to help me help you get merchandise, send an email to info@daniabeachcasino.com.
And you had mentioned earlier in the season that you wanted to maybe sell some jerseys, maybe order some for people, let them order what they wanted the name on the back to be, the number, yeah, and that sort of thing.
Yeah, that moved forward just a little bit. I talked to the guy that makes the jerseys. He doesn't have a problem fulfilling orders. The problem we had the last time, we did this with the amateurs years ago, and the problem that we had was the sporadic orders. So you order one today, someone orders one tomorrow, and so on and so forth. And then a lot of things, it's hard to keep track of these things. This is a small vendor that works for a big manufacturer that makes football, baseball, basketball uniforms. So it's not just a guy sitting at his house waiting for Highlight orders. You know, it's a big and then the other concern was, well, how are they going to pay for it? We don't take credit cards over the phone. We don't have a portal where you can go on the internet and order it and pay through PayPal or something like that. So that becomes an issue. So we thought, okay, so the people that come here can come here and order a jersey, and then we'll deal with, you know, ordering and having it delivered and all that. So that's where it's just kind of in the air of, we know we want to do it, and we know that the people want us to do it. The question is more in the how do we do it.
Speaking of costs and equipment and that sort of thing, I wanted to ask a couple questions and get a current update on the price of pelotas and cestas, because it's always been a very tough to get a hold of. They're made by hand over in the Basque Country, pretty much completely, sometimes in Mexico. But the balls are sown. At one time, Jalai pelotas were around $100. Cestas were around $250, $300. We've got inflation now. I'm sure all of that went way up.
Well, as far as I know, the baskets are still costing about the same, about $450. There's very few basket makers over there that are making baskets. But these guys come here, and they all have three or four baskets, new ones that they bring here, usually three new ones and maybe a used one. And I believe they're still paying around $450 each. The pelotas, the guy that's made our balls for many years, he's retired now, and he called me a couple of months ago, and he said that he has some balls that he would like to get rid of. He has a lot of people in Spain and France that also buy his pelotas, and he was willing to sell me 100 or 200 balls. Each ball would cost us $80 per ball, but then we have to put the goat skin in, which if you do the math, it comes out to about $110 per ball.
And is there anybody left making balls?
Well, that I know of, there should be some people that make balls in the Basque region and or maybe the Philippines. But that I know of, this is the only person right now. Like, he's got the market cornered. Like, he is the guy that everybody calls when they want pelotas.
I know you may not want to divulge this at this time, but you wanted to make some changes maybe to a couple of things with the equipment. You want to talk about that?
Well, you're talking about the pelotas? Yeah, actually, it's funny because they were talking about on Tiger's site, they were talking about how some customers or some people that are watching the games or betting don't like the strategy. Well, they understand the strategy, but they don't like when someone takes out a new ball because it slows the game down. It's a little more boring, more volleying, and they would rather have a fast ball to see the point go quicker and to see the nice shots, the picas and the big bounce rebotes and things like that. I mentioned to you yesterday that I think that it would help us a lot if we were to buy new balls for next year. And these balls, a highlight ball has anywhere between 102 and 105 grams of rubber. And when I started working here, we were using balls that were 104 grams. So these balls, I purchased them in 2018, and they were 105 grams. So they're a little bit faster. But these balls now, after the three or four seasons that we used them, they're a little bit slower now. They're burnt. You know, a highlight ball gets burnt out. The rubber inside gets really hot, and then it cools down. And that process back and forth for a period of 4 years, it affects the way the ball plays. So I would like to purchase at least 100 new balls for next December, which, by the way, we already applied for the dates of December, January, and February of next year, waiting for state approval. And I would like to go out and purchase 100 balls at 106 grams. So that way they'll be a little bit faster, a little bit more lively, and there'll be a couple of guys on this current roster that would benefit from a little bit more oomph in the ball.
Just making them heavier makes them faster?
Well, 106 grams of rubber. So what would happen is you would take off a gram of nylon. So it still weighs the same, about 122 grams. But with 106 grams of rubber, you're going to have a little bit less nylon. This game's about to end. There's nobody in line. I want to address one last thing because Mo asked this yesterday, and I was going to get to it, and I didn't get a chance. But he was asking if when we painted the court, if we put some sand, shark grip, I think it's called. Yes, we did. What we did was we took a 5 gallon jug and we put the amount that is recommended for 5 gallons. This is the stuff that when you walk on a garage floor or a patio floor at your house, they put this in so you don't slip, you know, so it grips a little bit, has a little like texture to it. So we did the front wall and we did about 15 to 20 feet of the back wall, and we did a whole coat of the shark grip, and then we did a second coat without it. So there's two coats, one of them with and one of them without.
Well, you don't want it to slide, but you know what that means. That means you got to buy more goat skins.
Yeah, the balls, the first couple of weeks of the season, the balls do get a little hairier quicker, but it's the price you have to pay for the ball not to fly later on as time goes on, and you know, eventually that starts to wear down, and then the ball will fly. So we put a little bit extra early on, and yes, it cost us more in goat skin, but the court's going to play better longer.
Someone we know very well also suggested maybe there should be a rule that you should be limited to the number of times you could bounce the ball before a point.
Yeah, that's funny. That's another story for another day. But, yeah, we're going to put a bounce clock is the joke. We're going to put a bounce clock, and you got 8 seconds to bounce and check what ball you want to play with. And then after that, if not, you lose the point.
Well, if games are too fast, then you don't have a product either.
Well, I mean, these games, these performances have been going upwards of 4 hours, and that's a long time. I mean, normally we're done in three and a half hours, and it just goes to show that these guys are starting to get used to the court and starting to volley a little bit more. But anyway, I got to go get some work done. It was great being with you, Dave. Great being with the people today. Tomorrow, Dave Lamont will be here, Friday night special. And I'll probably be up a couple of times tomorrow too. And then a week from tomorrow night is the first partido. Seed 1 is playing against Seed 8. And it's going to be game 10 right after the regular nine game performance.
Last question. Where do you keep your Emmy award? Is that on the mantle?
I don't have an Emmy, man. That's the only thing I think I'm missing. I mean, I've been very blessed with all the awards that I guess accidentally won. And there's another thing I want to talk about in another day, because effort was brought up earlier this week. Effort and lack thereof and things like that. So you and I have talked about this many moons ago, and maybe we'll do a segment on that in the upcoming days.
Okay, let's get to game 8. 2 games left tonight.
It's nice. It's nice. They put in a new marble wall, so it's like the wall in Guernica.
Yes.
Yeah, similar, like the nice marble wall. Yeah. Sorry, we'll talk later.
Yes.
This is game number 8. It is a doubles match, starting the late daily double. Spectacular 7 scoring. Serving wearing red post 1, Vicente and Oyenard. Receiving in blue post 2, Yagoba and Natan. There's a serve, and game 8 is on. First point will go to the wand. White shirts up post 3, here's Urrutia and Cabanillas. Point to post 1. 1 serving to post 4, wearing the green shirts, that's Aron and Uranga. Low hard one. By Oranga. That's off the cesta as Vicente went for the scoop, and it's point to the 4. Four will serve to post five in the black shirts, Chanika and Leke. Lifted too high into the overhead screen. Score for the five. Five will serve to six. In the gold shirts, Lalu and Danielle. Six. Here's post seven, wearing brown. That's Arieta and Zugaitz. That heads to the outside. Here's Arieta out on the wood. Inside placement scores. 27. Post eight in the purple shirts, Echeverry and Tukale. All points scored. Now we're double. Back in the court, Yagoba and a time post two. First to seven wins this game. Spins out of the cest of Tukale, point two. Here is the three, Rutia and Cabanillas. There's a Dejada running it down, shooting it outside. Is Yagoba, and it scores point two. Two will serve to one. Vicente and Oyenart. Scooped on the outside. Point two. 6 points, possible game point. Jogoba and a tie. They'll serve to the four. Aron and Uranga. Outside placement in the backcourt. It is caught by a time. He loses it on the throw, and it's pointing game post two. One takes second. Playoff now, 5 ways to play for show position. This playoff goes all the way to 7. First to 7 points, with points now double. We'll take show position. 5 will start off by serving the 6. Tipped at the sidewall, point six. 6-7-2, post 7. Overserve. Point 7. 7-7-8, Echeverry and Tukale. Inside Dejada, point to post 8. 8 serving to 4, Aron and Uranga. There's a carom, run down by Aron on the outside. Uranga, a low hard one to the outside, and that's into the screen. One bounce on the court though, and it scores, point four. Here's the 5, Chinika and Leke. Shooting into the back corner. And that's a Chick Shack winner by Aron, point to the four. Four team now at 5 points, so it is possible show point post four, serving to post six. Lalu and Danelle. And that was tipped, it's point and show, post four. Two-one-four, your order finish here in the eighth game. And your prices for game number eight, the 1-2 Quinella, 22-20. 2-1 exact to 47-20. 2-1-4 trifecta, 354 even. Ninth and final game of the night is up next. Spectacular nine doubles match. Played to 9 points, points doubling after round one. Post time is 6 minutes away now. Thank you. Last call for betting on the final game. Last call. Game 9, final game of the night, single, spectacular 9, scoring, serving, wearing red in post 1, Urrutia, receiving in blue post 2, Tukule. There's the serve, game 9 is on. Strong throw by Urrutia and the catch on the run by Tukule. Urrutia plays the rebote right down the sidewall to score point one. White shirt post 3, Lucky. Running that one down. Is Urrutia post one, he gets the point. Post 4 in green, Oyanok. Excellent throw by Arutia. Point to the wall. Into the pad, point to the five. Here's post six in goal, Chaniga. One to six. Brings out Aron and Brown, post seven. That one gets by Aron on the inside, point of the six. And here is post eight, Donnell. Bote inside, short hop pickup on the backhand by Donnell. Nice grab there by Chanika. This one comes way back out, goes to the inside with a big bounce and a great catch by Chanika. Donnell plays the Bote, goes outside and Chanika's there. Strong throw to the backcourt. Donnell hustles back, cannot make a Bote though, and it's point six. Three straight for post six, Chanika. He'll serve to Tukole now. Post two, points a double, first to nine, wins it. It's an over serve, point to the two. Here's Leke, post three. Chula dug out. Excellent play by Tukole. There's a Dejada by Leke, point three. Now three, serving to four, Oyenar. Thank you. There's a long Tejada run down in the front court by Oyenard. He'll flip his own Tejada back in there. And it's point forward. Four serving to one. Arutia back with 3 points. And that falls into the cushion. Point of the one. One now with 5 points. Don't forget it takes 9 to win this game. One serving to 5, Yagoba. Hard throw to the inside and the backhand caught there by Yagoba. And it comes low off the back wall to score point 5. Five, 7-7 out on. That is an overserve, 0.7. Bote save, keeps the point alive. Now here's Aron Chula. 0.7. Seven, 7-6, that's Janika. He's back with 3. That is too low into the pad, 0.6. Point six. Post six. Chenique now with 7 points, possible game point. He'll serve to Leke, post three. That is off the court, point three. And three will serve to four. Oyenard. Over serve. Point of the four. Four will serve to one. That's Urrutia. He's back with five. And that is an over serve. Point of the one. 7 points, impossible game point for post one. Urrutia, he'll serve to Yelgoba, post five. Inside placement, caught on the fly by Yagoba. Point five. I'm serving to post eight, Donnell. And that one gets by Donnell on the outside, point five. Possible game point for Jagoba now, post five. He'll serve to post seven, Aron. Catch at the sidewall, nice play to keep the point alive. That one goes inside, a big bounce, gets by. Aron, and it's pointing game post five, Yagoba. Place and show point now, 6-7-1. This will be for place and show. Too high, hits the upper pad. Point of place, post one, six will show. 5-1-6, shorter finish here in the ninth and final game. We still have the superfecta, the fourth place position to be filled. 3, 4, and 7 play for that spot. First three serving to four. It's the playoff for quad position. It's an ace serve. 23. Possible quad point for Leke, post 3. Serving out of post 7. Aron. Long two all, we'll score. 1-7. And now this will be quad point 7-7-3. The winner completes the superfecta. And the Karen will score. It's point and quad, post 7. Five, 1-6-7. Your order finish here in the ninth game superfecta. Winning it, post 5. Yagoba finishing second, post 1. Urrutia coming in third, post 6. Janika finishing fourth, post 7. Aron. The Kinella 1-5, the Exacta 5-1, the Trifecta 5-1-6, the Superfecta 5-1-6 and 7. Price is now posted. One-five Kinella 38-20, 5-1 Exacta $61. 5-1-6 Tri 252-80. 5-1-6-7 Superfect on the $1 ticket, $1,751.20. Daily Double is a 2-5 combination, $129.60. Pick four numbers, 8, 4, 2, and 5. 3 of 4 gets back $47.50. Your new carryover jackpot is now $98.81. And your pick three is a 4-2-5. 606 even is the return for 3 out of 3. And that will do it, ladies and gentlemen. That'll conclude the action here at Dania High Line here at the casino at Dania Beach on a Thursday night. We'll be back tomorrow night with more exciting action beginning at 7 o'clock. Doubleheader on Saturday, 1 and 7, and the Sunday matinee at 1. We thank you for being with us tonight. We hope you'll join us all weekend long as we move toward the new year. For Benny Bueno, I'm Big Dave Lemon saying bye-bye from High Line.